The pace of life is slow and easy in the village of Taghmon in County Wexford. Rarely, at even the peak of Taghmon's rush hour, will you find more than a dozen people in the main street. As the women go about their shopping or carry water from the pump, and the men stroll to or from a bottle of stout. The quiet is shattered, the pace changed only once a week by the Thursday cattle mart, the business and social event of the week. With its parish pump and thatched houses, Taghmon is a picture postcard Irish village, even if the edges are a little time frayed. But the routine has been interrupted. Just a few weeks ago, three local children ran home to their parents, frightened. They had seen, they said, an apparition in a disused cemetery on the village outskirts.
My son and two other boys were playing down in the mart. It was just near the cemetery, you know. And I don't know how long they were there, but he came up to his lunch. He was a bit late and he came in, he was very excited. I was getting the dinner, I was up to my eyes in work, you know. And I said, come on and have your dinner. I said, what kept you? So he said, Mummy, he said, I saw the Blessed Mother, Blessed Virgin, he said, down in the cemetery. And I said, what cemetery? And he said, the one opposite the mart. And I said, you're joking. I said, you couldn't see the Blessed Virgin. I said, come on and have your dinner. And he went into the sitting room and he said, come here, Mummy, and I'll show you how I saw her. He knelt down, joined his hands, and he looked up and he said, I saw her like that, but she wasn't kneeling. She was just standing at a tree. And I said to him, where did she go? And he said, she just went up in the tree.
Local reaction is non-committal. Most will agree that the children saw something, but what? Explanations of pranks are ruled out. Few will risk saying it wasn't an apparition or wasn't the Blessed Virgin, just in case it happens again. It's one thing to argue with three local families. It's quite another to lose favour with the Lord. The boys were playing in the cattle mart which borders on the disused cemetery. Through the dividing bushes, Gerald O'Sullivan, the Garda Sergeant's son, Con Quigley, son of the shopkeeper, and Eric Fenlon, an auctioneer's son, saw, they say, a woman in blue. Two other children at the same spot saw nothing.
We weren't playing. We thought somebody was following us. Somebody was following us. My sister was following us. She's over there, red skirt.
And had you been hiding from her?
No, kind of, you know, we're in the shed over there.
And what was it you saw?
I saw her first, and the whole graveyard started lighting up, and then a woman appeared, and I told Eric Fenlon, and then Eric Fenlon told Con, and then I started fading away when
there's the other lad over there.
So only one of you saw the woman, is that right?
No, the three of us. I saw it first, and Eric Fenlon saw it second, and he saw it third.
But when you say the graveyard lit up, what do you mean? How did it light up?
It start rays of the sun start lighting up, raining down on the grave where she stood.
See. But wasn't it a fairly dull day on that day?
Yeah, it was fairly. And it was only a bright spot over there at the grave.
You mean sort of a ray of sunshine?
Yeah.
Well, did it look strange or was it just an ordinary ray of sunshine?
It was strange.
In what way?
Because it went like a ring around the place. The ring around the place where she stood.
Hello. What was it you saw?
I saw a lady in a blue dress over there.
and she had a white veil on her head, and she was about 6 feet tall or something, 5 feet or 6 feet tall. And she was about 2 inches off the ground, and she had a ring around her head.
What about this ray of sunshine?
Yeah, there was a sort of ray of sunshine around the grave there.
Did it last for long?
About 2 minutes or so.
And how about the woman? How would you describe her now?
The same. Blue frock down to her toes and a white shawl down here. Right here.
And did she stay there for long?
Not about a minute or two. And then start when we ran, start fading away.
Only when you ran away?
Yeah.
Well, did she say anything?
No. She had her hands folded and looking up like that.
How? Can you?
Like that.
Is it possible one of your friends was sort of joking you?
No, we have no friends that's 6 feet tall.
Were you very close to her?
No, just over there. In the cattle mart.
So you're quite
kind of close, you know. We could see her plainly, but we were a good bit away.
Well, how are you so sure that she was off the ground?
Well, she sort of looked a little bit off the ground, didn't she, Gerald? Yeah.
When you ran away, what happened to the woman?
She started fading away, and then she went, and the rays went too.
So apparently you told one of your parents that you disappeared up into a tree.
No, somebody said that. I don't know who said it. That's not true. Over there. One of the fellas over there. It's not true.
Your mother apparently thinks that you said she went up into a tree.
No, I didn't say it. Donald said it. My brother.
Do you read at school about the Blessed Virgin?
No. Sometimes. Sometimes in catechism, but not very many times. It's usually about gospels and things like that.
But did you ever say read anything about Fatima?
Yeah, I read about that.
What? But is there a clear picture in your mind of what went on at Fatima? What do you think it was like there?
Three children, they were saying their prayers, and a lady appeared to them and said something to them.
Well, does that sort of impress you that Our Lady appears to children?
Yeah.
Is it important?
I don't know.
Do you think now that maybe you're fairly important now that she appeared to you?
No.
Why not?
Well, I don't feel important anyway.
Do you think it's of any importance at all?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
Do people talk to you about it?
Yeah.
Well, what sort of things do they want to know?
They ask me to pray for them and all.
Were you frightened at the time, or did it seem strange to you at the time when you saw the woman?
It seemed sort of a bit strange. Because it wasn't like a day that people come out to be praying. It was a dull sort of day. And people wouldn't be out praying, and it was a cold wind, and people wouldn't be out praying.
Were you at all frightened, Gerald?
No.
How did you feel about it at the time?
All right.
Well, when you went home to your mammy, were you frightened?
Yeah, a bit frightened.
Why? I mean, were you afraid of the woman here, or do you think that people wouldn't believe you, or what was it?
No, because the people mightn't believe me.
Is it at all possible, lads, that the three of you maybe got together and talked about this?
No, because they'd be always all the time. No, they'd be always with us. They'd be following us all the time. And I'd be afraid to make up a story like that in case they did it really, really.
Well, what about the other two lads who were here? They didn't see anything.
No, there was three. The three. Him and him. The fellow with the dog. Two lads with the dogs and the fellow with the big black coat.
Well, how is it they didn't see anything?
I don't know. I don't think they looked over.
They did. But me, I got up in the bars first, and then my brother got up. He didn't see anything. And then the rest of us got up in the bars. And only three of us saw it.
But again, you know, could you not be making it up, maybe?
No,
I'd be afraid.
In case you'd be caught out?
Tricked.
Sorry?
Tricked.
Anyway, I wouldn't like to do it.
Do you think maybe you were tricking?
No.
One of the boys had been reading about Fatima a few weeks beforehand. Another had seen a film of the story of Bernadette of Fatima some months beforehand. The apparition they describe conforms with the popular image of the Blessed Virgin. The clergy of the area have been silent on the alleged apparition. No guidance whatever has been given, just in case another apparition occurs. Because of that lack of guidance, the story of the apparition has gained credibility locally. But should any importance be attached to this or any other claims of apparitions? Head of the Department of Psychology, University College Dublin, Reverend Professor Fekin O'Doherty.
The answer is absolutely none, none whatsoever. The church attaches no importance to these apparitions on the ground that the revelation of Christ ceased with the death of the last apostle. And these events, these alleged events, have no relationship whatsoever to the content of the faith.
Well, how about places like Lourdes and Fatima now? Are you saying that nothing happened there?
Oh, Lourdes is exceptional. I would accept, for example, the testimony of miracles where that is available. Now, it would be rash, I believe, to reject that as regards Lourdes. But as regards Fatima, Borang, Garabandal, anybody can legitimately reject assent, or refuse, rather, assent to any of these apparitions.
But if it happened in Lourdes, could it not as easily happen anywhere else?
Not as easily. If, in fact, there has been an intervention, a supernatural intervention from on high at Lourdes, this would, first of all, have to be justified by an adequate reason. Now, the adequate reason at Lourdes could very well be the testimony to the Immaculate Conception. But there's no such adequate reason to justify alleged apparitions elsewhere. And in addition, as far as any human investigation can go, I think anybody would be convinced by the Medical Bureau at Lourdes, whereas there is no such evidence in these other areas you mentioned.
What sort of a ratio do you get to claims of apparitions and actual confirmations?
Nobody could give you figures on that, but in a parallel instance, there were about 200 claims to the stigmata in the 19th century, not one of which was authenticated. Now, these claims to apparitions appear fairly regularly in my own lifetime, at intervals of about 2 years, I should think, and not one of them has ever been authenticated. I think that out of all the claims made in the history of the church, the only one that I can personally see as authenticated is Lourdes, the only one. None of the others necessarily involve any physical apparition of any kind, although they remain places of pilgrimage and perhaps even holy places.
Why all these claims? Do people actually see something, or are they trying to assume some self-importance?
No, I don't think it'd be fair to say they're trying to assume some self-importance, and I don't think it's fair to say they see something. I think the truth of the matter is, and it varies with the age group, in the older age groups, it is very likely that it is a projection of some emotional disturbance on the seer's part. Now, in the younger age groups, the 11, 12, early adolescent age groups, I think it's simply a phenomenon that the psychologist knows as eidetic imagery, an image with the vividness of reality, and the youngster is just not in a position to decide whether it's imagery or reality. Now, the more his claim is taken seriously, the more he's going to insist that what he saw was real.
In this particular case down in Taghmon in County Wexford, can you see any merit in their claim?
None whatsoever. No, no. This fits into the pattern that recurs around the world. I think it's rather a pity, in a way, that even programs such as this are sent out, because this kind of program might have the effect of reinforcing the belief of the youngsters, or at least making it more difficult for them to climb down. But this kind of thing happens all the time.
But what sort of an explanation would you see for the whatever event took place there?
Well, in the first instance, as I say, what we call eidetic imagery, an image subjectively experienced with the vividness of reality and projected in the circumstances of a graveyard and an old lady sitting on a tombstone. I mean, anything could be the basis of the projected image, but that it should be taken seriously as a preternatural or supernatural intervention is very foolish indeed. It should not be taken seriously. It should not even be considered as a possibly serious event.
Well, even the local church apparently is considering it in that they won't come out and say it never happened.
Well, the only person that could really give a verdict on this is the local bishop, and I understand he's abroad. But at the time of a similar claim in Meath Diocese, the Bishop of Meath simply stated bluntly that there was no basis for the claim. And this ended the matter in a few, 24 hours or a few days at the most.
But the church has certainly been silent for whatever reason down in County Wexford. Does this not tend to contribute to the uncertainty and the confusion?
I agree entirely. I wish that the officials of the church in Ferns Diocese had taken action more finally and perhaps with greater clarity at a much earlier stage in this business.
Would it have died completely then?
I think it would. I think this is what happens. Well, at least put it this way. Wherever action has been taken quickly enough and finally enough, there has been no further problem.
See, they seem to be hedging their bets in that they're not saying anything in case it happens again.
Well, I can understand that cautious people would take that line. Cautious perhaps for the wrong reasons. People who are not clear in their own minds about the irrelevance of these alleged apparitions and the fact that the vast majority of such claims have not been substantiated. But you see, if you have been brought up with what is sometimes called a simple faith, and I would call it an unsophisticated credulity, then, of course, I think you'll be a little less ready to reject out of hand these matters. But the more your faith is a genuine supernatural faith, the less it will depend on this kind of evidence, and therefore the more ready you will be to wipe these things out at once.